Okay, thanks, Tom. With that, I'll bring up Jonah, and he'll introduce our speaker, and we'll get moving. Thanks very much. Excuse me. Our speaker today is Vic Lund. You heard him introduce himself earlier. Vic has been a been an engineer in St. Louis County since 2007. Has been involved. I looked him up earlier and found a laundry list of events that he's been a part of, projects he's been a part of, including Towards Zero Deaths, as well as Work Zone Safety. And something that I learned today just from talking to people here, that when people talking about Vic, is how integral he's been in providing information to the students here, and how helpful he's been there. So as he was discussing kind of providing knowledge and discussing ideas is king, and that's something that he's been very much a part of with the students here. So with that, I am happy to introduce Vic Lund.
Thank you for that introduction, Jonah. I get a little nervous when people start saying that they're looking me up on the internet. That's okay. Just a little bit more about my background. I know some of you webinar land know who I am, and but for those who don't, I graduated from Michigan Tech University with my Bachelor of Science degree in civil engineering. And then after that, a little more expansive, but I got married when I was in college. And so when my wife finished up her master's degree at Tech, we moved to Ames, Iowa, and I went to Iowa State University, received my Master of Science in Civil Engineering with an emphasis in Transportation Engineering. And I would like to, you know, usually I'll tell people that the stuff that I say, I guess, thank you for inviting me to speak today. I do appreciate that. I guess in terms of timing, it's a great timing for the presentation with the storm coming in tomorrow. You know, it couldn't have worked out better, I think. And Dr. Quad says yes, leave and go down to the cities tomorrow afternoon or tomorrow morning, so I'm hoping that you can get out here soon in time for that. With Michigan Tech, of course, I'd be remiss to say that if I didn't talk about the snow. So with our snow event coming in tomorrow, for me, it's like, big deal. when you're dealing with 15 feet of snow annually in Hope, Michigan, it's kind of like, that's okay. So I'm going to talk today about innovative intersections. And this topic, obviously, you know, I think it could be classified as an emerging topic nationally as well as regionally. However, the intersection designs themselves are not emerging in terms of recent time period. A lot of these intersections we're going to talk about today have found their source in various states across the union decades ago. So, for example, the reduced conflict intersection, or J-turn, that I believe had found its source in the Maryland DOT area of the world, and that was back in the 1980s. In Minnesota, we have just started implementing the J-turn, I think around 2011, or about their time, was about the first J-turn, I think, in the state. But since then, I will show a map later, but there's been dozens built and dozens more planned, for example. Same thing for roundabouts. One of the innovative intersections that do exist, roundabouts have been around for a long time, especially outside of the United States. But specifically, I think about the state of Wisconsin, where they've been involved with roundabout design for decades, going back well into the 1990s. So again, we're not talking about new intersection design per se, but we're talking about the fact that a lot of states have actually recognized the value of these different intersection designs, and now we're actually taking that time and implementing. Really, in the last 5 to 10 years, we've seen a tremendous growth in the installation and implementation of these systems. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention why the emphasis on innovative intersections. It comes down to the single word safety. Single word safety. At the end of the day, really the customer of the public sector, of the transportation agencies that exist out there, really the customer is the traveling public. That reminds me of a story that I personally experienced to kind of emphasize this concept of the priority being the customer safety. A couple years ago, I was coming back from a trip to Columbus, Ohio for a Federal Highway Administration peer exchange. And on the way back from the last leg of the flight from Minneapolis to Duluth, I remember it clearly, it was a Wednesday evening in June, but in June in Duluth, one of the big things we deal with is fog. And so at the time, we were reconstructing the main runway, and so the side runway was the only runway that was open. And so Wednesday evening, I took off, our flight came up to Duluth. Everything was going great. Pilot even said that we were expecting to land 15 minutes as normal, their normal routine. 5 minutes before I would expect us to be on the ground, all of a sudden the pilot came on the intercom and said, folks, I apologize, there's dense fog on the runway. We're going to have to circle for a while, and hopefully we have an opening, we can land. So we circled for about 15 minutes. Then I noticed the flaps pull up and the throttles increase, and I thought, oh boy. And of course, my wife is down there, you know, somewhere by the airport waiting for me. If we get back to Minneapolis, that was it for the night. And so I ended up getting a free stay in the Minneapolis airport for nothing. It was great. But the next morning, we took off again about 7:30 in the morning. Same group of folks. Got to Duluth 5 minutes before we were expected to land. Pilot came over the intercom. Different pilot. Sorry, folks. There's fog on the ground. We're gonna have to circle for a while. Hopefully, we get an access and we can land. About 15 minutes later, flaps come up, throttles increase, we're going back to Minneapolis. And at that point, I just thought that was kind of interesting. And then, so finally by 11 a.m., the fog had burned off from Minneapolis all the way up to Duluth, and we were able to land successfully. But think about it this way. I paid for that one leg, but I got 5 legs free, basically. But the airline was their priority. Think about it. Their priority was they're willing to pay those 5 extra trips for the safety of their customers. And that's the seriousness of which the airline takes it. And I remember sitting next to a lady on the second flight in the morning that got resurfaced and came back in the morning. And she was kind of giving the stewardess a hard time. And I remember the stewardess saying, well, wouldn't you like for your, she was complaining that her daughter's there waiting for her to pick her up. And she said, wouldn't you like it that your daughter can actually pick you up? You know, actually be able to land and go on with your life. So that really spoke to me about really emphasizing how we as agencies, as transportation agencies, really the customer is our priority. You know, as a data-driven approach, we don't rely on hope. Hope is not an engineering strategy. And so it's a data-driven endeavor. And so we're very evidence-based people. Actually, that fits with engineers. But when we do our best to find whatever data we can and utilize that data to our advantage when we start implementing these safety strategies. Towards Zero Best, the initiative here in Minnesota, other states have different names for it. I think Wisconsin refers to it as Vision Zero. Different take, same purpose. But notice that it's not towards zero crashes. And that's going to be key as we talk about the basis for the design of innovative intersections and the benefit of them. So a lot of times the public will perceive these innovative intersections as problematic, they'll increase crashes. That misses the boat entirely. We're not here to reduce crashes per se, we're here to reduce serious crashes, ultimately minimize and eliminate those crashes. One thing I will say about Towards Zero Deaths is it appears to be a pretty lofty goal. When I first started at St. Louis County in 2007, if you would have asked me at that time, honestly, Vic, give me the heart of hearts, you think it's possible? You think it's possible? And I would have said, genuinely, no. At that time, genuinely, no, I do not think it's possible. Folks have different opinions, and that's perfectly fine. If I could take everything that I've done in the last 11 years, everything I've seen, everybody I've talked to, everything I've done, I've been to 3 different peer exchanges across the country with Federal Highway Administration on safety planning. I'm convinced more than ever today, if you were to ask me what is my heart of hearts, that it is possible. That I honestly do believe that it is possible. The key, though, is not to focus on large data sets. For example, in Minnesota right now, we're ahead of fatality numbers from last year. Currently, as of this date, we're ahead of 2018. 2018 was greater than 2017. 2017 is actually was the low in the state since World War II, but we've unfortunately been climbing for the last couple of years. But it's best to think about your county, and it's best to think about your system. So when I think about Towards Zero Deaths, I think about the county road system because that's what I'm tasked to, and responsible to address. And so, for example, we have 5 to 8 fatal crashes per year on average on the county road system in St. Louis County. In 2016, we experienced 2 fatal crashes in totality in the county road system. We came dangerously close in a positive sense of the word dangerous, but we came very, very close to achieving zero. And that, I think, is the key for us as practitioners, is to think about, don't get lost in the big data set, although it's important, but think about your county, think about your system that you're tasked to maintain, or your system of helping to lower those numbers, because if we look at it that perspective, it makes it a lot easier and clearer for me as a practitioner when I think about it on a local level than I do at the state level. I like this slide not for the sake of what's in it, but how well it demonstrates the problem. This is national fatality data from 2017. I think it's the latest published data I found on FARS. And so in 2017, we had 37,000 people killed on all roads in the US. 37,000 is even a big number for me. And so I have to break it down to get a better grasp of what that means. The second bullet point really speaks the most to me. 102, so let's say 100 fatalities per day on all roads in the US. So at the end of, so by midnight tonight, we'll have lost another 100 people, someplace in the US on some traffic crash. If you think about it from, and I know this is apples and oranges, so bear with me, but if you think about it on an airline perspective, you know, a typical airliner, if you're gonna fly from Duluth to Minneapolis, you're gonna have about 70 to 100 people on that flight. So that's the equivalent of having one airline of that type of, more of a regional airline, crash per day, killing everybody on board. It happens every day, every day, every day. The newspaper is always the same. Nothing ever changes, just a different location. Rhetorical question, don't answer. Would you be more likely, less likely, equivalent likelihood to fly if that were the case? And again, I know it's apples and oranges, but in terms of human impact, this is what we're dealing with. So it's a hefty task. Which brings us to the need of innovative intersections, because ultimately, as Towards Zero Death, we have, that's the big picture of getting down to zero in the macro sense. But actually, what paths do we need to take to get to zero? And intersections is one of the main paths. If we don't address intersection crashes, we will never get to zero deaths in Minnesota. It's just the way it is. The green area basically represents single vehicle runoff road crashes. This is, I should have backed up, this is 2017 Minnesota fatal crashes from FARS, not fatalities, but fatal crashes. So the green represents basically single vehicle runoff the road, which is the most frequent type of serious or fatal crash in the United States. Typically what happens, the person will run off the road, obviously, but then they'll usually impact a fixed object like a tree. Excuse me. They'll be unbelted, the car will flip, they'll be ejected out of the car. But basically, what will happen is if you wait for the next article that you read online in your local newspaper, you're on your local TV station, the very strong probability of the next fatal crash you hear will be a single vehicle runner that runs off the road. That's just the way it is. I'm not Nostradamus. It's just the data just bears itself out. That's just the way it is. But the second most problematic location are intersections. And I'll get into which specific intersections, but within intersections, it's those angle crashes, those T-bone type crashes, the ones that our bodies are just not designed to withstand. I mean, think about it this way. You're on a two-way or a side street stop control intersection, for say. You're pulling out from the side street, your vector. You think back to your physics class, it's vectors, direction, and speed. You're proceeding across the intersection at, say, 10 miles per hour, but your sideways vector between, you know, cutting through your vehicle at a 90-degree angle, that is zero. You're not going that direction, and you're not going any speed in that direction. So your body and your internal organs are going straight. The problem is then when you get T-boned by somebody, whether it's in your passenger side or if in your driver's side, now your body instantaneously goes from 0 to 60 in that direction, and your internal organs can't withstand that type of impact. And that's why predominantly you see people that they bleed out internally, is because the traumatic impact is too much. The physics The physics are not in our favor when it comes to our human body design of withstanding those types of crashes. So that's why the first clue here today is, how do we address angle crashes? But there's a larger challenge that faces us. You know, we know the need of addressing intersections for safety, but the challenge is that the funding aspect, there just simply isn't enough money to reconstruct all these intersections. I use the word keyword reconstruct. So that really pushes us into this realm of low cost, proactive, innovative type design intersections to say, how can we leverage benefits that are going to make improvements without necessarily building an entire interchange? How can we achieve those performance goals without relying on a traditional approach? Think about it this way. So our construction has basically ceased in terms of the addition of new lane miles in the U.S. I mean, it's not the 1960s, 1970s anymore where we were constructing miles and miles and miles of lane miles every single year. We're basically plateaued for the last decade. But the significant question remains is maintenance. How do we maintain what we built? You know, we're kind of like painted ourselves in a funding corner of sorts where, well, okay, we have this great system. It's the envy of the world. But how do we actually maintain it? Because now, you know, these pavements are 20, 30, 40 years old and they're needing reconstruction. And we have to figure out a way to maintain that. So it's difficult when I am competing against my resident engineers in my office who are repaving our roadways. And so guess what? The bulk of the funding in St. Louis County and any other agency is going to go to maintaining our roadways. That's just the way it is. And that probably should be the way it is. And that's missing that. But how do I justify to my superiors, how do you justify to your superiors that we need to make investments in intersections? Hopefully we can answer that question today. But the answer, part of the answer, I think, is thinking outside the box, looking at innovative intersections. Let's talk about intersection safety, generally speaking, and we'll go into some more specifics. When you boil it all down, intersection safety is pretty much predicated on or predicted on two variables. That's the traffic volume and the conflict points, for the most part. There's other things that contribute, influence, I get it, but when it all boils down to the two biggest things in the room, I believe that they're traffic volume and conflict points. Well, guess what? We can't do anything about traffic volumes. They're stuck or growing. That's just the way it is. So we have no cards to play when it comes to traffic volume. But the card we do have to play, thankfully we do have a card, it's called conflict points. And so that's what I would argue is the best strategy at improving intersection safety is addressing conflict points specifically. If you're not familiar with the conflict point terminology, basically what it is if you're to draw, like this diagram indicates in the lower right corner, if you're to draw the path of every single vehicle that a vehicle could make a turning movement through an intersection, and then draw a little dot where one path intersects another path, that represents a conflict point. And there's in a traditional four-lane intersection like this with pedestrian crosswalks, there's 32 conflict points in a traditional four-lane intersection. But not all conflict points are created equal. There's high severity conflict points and there's low severity conflict points, which will be a clue. That's another clue here as we get further into the presentation. You might be wondering why I threw a picture of marbles on the lower left-hand corner. I didn't do it for fun to dress up the screen at all, but actually I did it to make a point, a figurative point, maybe an allegory. Every time you drive through an intersection, think of that you have a pot of marbles in your passenger seat. You have white marbles, which are the predominant number of marbles in your canister, that represent no crash. Hopefully, every time you drive through the intersection, you randomly pull out a white marble. Okay? Then you have green marbles, which represent property damage only crashes. There's a fewer number of them, but they're the most, or second number of marbles. Hopefully you don't draw them, but if you do, yeah, you have to deal with it. Yellow represents minor injury crashes, red represents serious injury crashes, and black represents fatal crashes. So the goal and the hope is that when you drive through an intersection, you can draw a white marble out every single time. However, unfortunately, many people draw out the yellows, some draw out the reds, and tragically some draw out the blacks. And that's just the way it is. So the goal with addressing conflict points is removing or reducing the number of black marbles, reducing the number of red marbles. It's basically what we're doing. So my point with this illustration is it's a game of probability. We're removing the opportunity with these types of strategies for people to make dumb decisions. And I don't say that flippantly or casually, but I mean it in a genuine sense of interest for their safety. But we're removing the opportunity for people to make bad decisions when they're at these intersections. For some reason, I think this is a human factors thing, but we as people don't do a very good job. We do a pretty good job. I mean, obviously, intersection crashes are very rare. Frequency, thankfully, but our cognition of recognizing an acceptable gap and an unacceptable gap. That's something happens there. So then the question becomes, well, what types of conflict points are the serious ones? And this is a question of severity versus frequency. Obviously, we have in the previous slide here these different conflict points. They're left turns, right turns, run off the road crashes. But right angles are the problem. They're the most frequently severe crash at all intersections. Rear end conflict points are the second, well, they're tied for right angle crashes in frequency, but they're low severity. If you break it down between signal intersections and stop control intersection crashes, the story is still the same. Right angle crashes, that's still the problem. Right angle crashes more so at stop control intersections and less so at signal lines. You might be asked the question, you know, as a side story, why are there right angle crashes at signals? By definition, there should be, right? I mean, we have multi-malfunction units, MMUs, in these controller cabinets that are monitoring the controller. I'm pretty sure we're not showing the green indications to both directions, right? So something's happening. So that question becomes, you know, illustrating which conflict points are the problem. Again, it's angle crashes. So the graph that you're seeing here is St. Louis County crashes at four-legged intersections. So all four-legged intersections in St. Louis County, whether they're on the state system, they're on the county system, the city system, doesn't matter. It's all four-legged intersections. And the crash data from 20, so it's 10 years of crash data. And so we have the type of crash, if it's a right angle, left turn, something, and then versus the severity of the crash. And you can see that in your K&As, which is the focus of today, that right angle crashes, again, are king. Those are the most frequent, serious crash that you're going to experience at these unsignalized intersections. But look, as you decrease your severity, the frequency of these other crash types become more pronounced, which is a clue. If your safety program is predicated on a metric of treating all crashes, you're going to spend most of your time in your safety program in the urban areas. That's where you're going to spend most of your time. If your safety program is predicated on a serious crash only, or addressing serious crashes, you're going to spend most of your time outside of cities, outside of urban areas, at rural intersections. Specifically, if you get down into the data, it's side street stop control intersections, correlated, and expressway at-grade intersections, side street stop control. Those two intersection types are the problem. If I could boil everything down to say which intersection, okay, Vic, you convinced me that intersections are the problem in the rural areas, which intersections are they? Which one should I spend most of my time on? Look at the number of conflict points in the traditional intersection. There's only four crossing conflict points that produce those angle crashes. Only four. Yet in St. Louis County, they represent 60% of all serious crashes. They're the lowest number of conflict points within any intersection, but their overrepresentation is huge. 60% of all serious crashes are due to angle crashes. Overrepresentation to a T. All right, so what's the answer? We talked about the problem, we talked about the fact that angle crashes are really the key here to addressing intersection safety. So how do we address this? Well, we've been trying the traditional approach, which is, I'll preface this by saying, I'm not saying that we shouldn't continue with the traditional approach. I'm not saying that at all. In fact, in a comprehensive approach, we need to have traditional intersections for a variety of reasons. But if it's a traditional only approach, I don't think we're going to be making progress if it's traditional only. And so what I mean by a traditional intersection, typically a signalized intersection, you increase the level of control from no traffic control to side street stop control to always stop to a traffic signal. That's the traditional progression of control type through time for an intersection life. So in the traditional approach, basically what we would do as engineers is sit back and watch this signal warrant meter. When the meter gets to the red, throw in a traffic signal. Write yourself an SJR, a signal justification report, throw in a traffic signal, we're done. They can walk away. But again, remember the problem is, if we go back up a few slides to right here, signalized intersections in the upper left-hand corner, we're still experiencing red angle crashes, which tells me something. Signals are not safety devices. And this is one of the messaging things we're going to get to later. I'm going to talk just kind of, I'm going to try to pull back the curtain for you here in this room as well as Minneapolis of how do I, as an agency engineer, convince the public, because at the end of the day, it's a political game. It really is. How do I convince the public that not putting in a signal is the best way to go? Okay, we'll talk about that. But the data is very clear on this point. Simply increasing the level of control at an intersection does not result in a decrease in serious crashes. It does not result in a decrease in serious crashes. If you look at all crashes, when you install a traffic signal, you actually have more crashes typically in the after period than you do in the before period. Totality of crashes. So something that obviously is not the answer. So again, I think it comes back to this root of the problem, which is conflict points. All right. I'm not sure there is a formal definition of innovative intersections, so I struggled a little bit when I put this presentation together. So I came up with a list of attributes that I think encapsulate what an innovative intersection is. Number one, it's an intersection that improves traffic flow and safety through geometric changes, specifically non-traditional geometric changes. Okay, so we're using geometry to change paths of vehicles that are traversing through the intersection. Sometimes a non-traditional or innovative intersection may incorporate elements of a traditional intersection, such as stop signs, yield signs, or signals. I think about yield signs at a roundabout. Sometimes we have a signalized reduced conflict intersection or a super street intersection. So we're utilizing traditional methods of control in conjunction with an innovative intersection design. Typically, these intersection designs do not require some sort of a warrant. Right? There is not a roundabout warrant. It doesn't exist. There is not a J-turn warrant. There's not an interchange warrant. We have engineering judgment. We have guidance that does exist out there, a lot of wealth of information. But there isn't a formal process or procedure that I can say, I met warrant 1, 2, 3, 4, therefore I'm justified to put in this J-turn. Okay? I would, as a side note, recommend that when you're considering doing an innovative intersection, always checking for that signal warrant, because then that helps bolster the fact of, you know, we have to do something. I mean, a signal is warranted, so we can't just not do anything, but we can use that as leverage to think about in the broader context of what can we do. What he does is you can find its footprints or its trace, its fingerprints, and you can see that there's a reduced number of conflict points in totality, as well as severity of conflict points. Okay? So where we might consider installing an innovative intersection, or when, or why? Specifically, I guess the question here is why. Delay in congestion, traffic capacity. So we're having an issue with maybe it's a T-type intersection like this in the lower left-hand corner. I'll talk about that later. But you might be having a side street stop control at a T intersection, excessive 3, 4, 5 minutes of delay. I need to do something. I can throw out a traffic signal, but is there another way of looking at this intersection? You might have an intersection that has poor safety performance. So it's not necessarily a traffic demand question. It's just that in terms of risk, in terms of crash history, it's high risk, high crash. So it's a problem. Sometimes innovative intersections are really useful to addressing access management concerns. So if you're thinking about a multi-lane, undivided corridor, maybe kind of in a suburban area, they might lend themselves very well to treating access management. Sometimes you might have unique site-specific geometric challenges. Here in Duluth, I call it the five-legged monster. The intersection doesn't exist anymore, but it was in West Duluth. It was an always stop with five legs. And the legs came in, literally looked like an octopus, right? Interesting enough, when you find one of those oddball intersections, which they exist around the state, and I'm convinced it's the case elsewhere as it is here at Oakland and Duluth, that was the safest intersection in Duluth. I mean, everything about it said, screamed to me as a traffic engineer, I am wrong, I'm bad, I need to get fixed. And that's all I saw when I looked at that intersection. But it was the safest intersection. In terms of traffic capacity and a delay in operations, it was operating really that bad. But we were reconstructing the roadway, and obviously we wanted to do something different. You know, the thing that was actually, we were joking in a respectful sense inside our office was, you know, when we reconstruct this intersection into a traditional four-legged intersection, it'll probably have the crash rate go up. And so that was kind of a weird thing for me sitting at the table of design and saying, what we're gonna do is probably gonna make it worse. So we tried to put in elements into that design, like offset left turn lanes, to try to minimize that, but it is what it is. And then maybe you have a traditional intersection, maybe it's signalized, maybe it's an always stop that just simply, it just is not performing the way it ought to, and you need to look outside the box of how to make improvements at that maybe mature level of control intersection. Specific site considerations when you're considering an innovative intersection. So as you identify a site or sites, things that you need to be cognizant of, be aware of these things because you're going to need them later. Obviously, traffic demand is going to pay a lot of attention to, you know, the design. For example, a roundabout, is it a single lane roundabout or is it a multi-lane roundabout? Well, we know the experience of multi-lane roundabouts is in Minnesota. It can be a little challenging at times, getting people to learn how to drive through a multi-lane roundabout. So maybe that pushes you in a different direction. So be cognizant of your demand volume. Cross-sectional design of the major intersection. You're not going to put a roundabout on a high-speed expressway. It's not going to happen. And so beware of your cross-section. Turn to the distribution. Well, what if I have a heavy left turn? If I were to do a specific design, maybe that design doesn't suit itself very well to that really heavy left turn movement. So be aware of your turning movements. Driver expectations. Will drivers, after you build this innovative intersection, will they, on the very first day, be able to drive through it in a reasonable sense? Keyword, reasonable sense. Okay? I'll explain this. I'll use this example right now. Maybe bring it up later. When we opened up our first continuous green T intersection here in Duluth in 2016, I was out there for the official opening. And I was very interested as a traffic engineer to watch people behave and how they would treat or react to this intersection. So we told the news when it's going to be open and this kind of stuff. So I'm sitting out there on the side street, so it'll be the T stem of the T intersection, and watching people as they first come through. And I remember the very first person who came up to that intersection. And so on the major road, of course, with the continuous green T, we have continuous flow in one direction. And so this person on the side street, the green signal indication came up and that they can make a left turn. And they got out in the intersection, creeped, and they stopped. Because in their field of view, they saw this vehicle on their right coming at them at high speed. Well, intuitively, think about this. Our drivers are not used to making a left turn movement from a side street when the through vehicle on the major street is coming through at 55 miles per hour. We're just not used to that. And so that's what I mean by driver expectations, is how will people react? Well, they can, I mean, it works well on paper, it models great, everything works about it, but can drivers drive through it? That's the question. So at the end of the day, the traffic engineer is the advocate for the driver. really, that's our job as traffic engineers. And community support. Yeah, that's a big question, community support. You know, we'll get into this later. I have some slides on messaging, but as traffic engineers, whether we like it or not, well, I'll say this is kind of a casual comment. Engineers generally don't like people. It's just the way we are. And if we could get away with living in a cubicle or an office with the door closed, doing computations 8 hours a day, I think we'd be pretty happy people. But that's not the reality of the situation. And so we as engineers, especially transportation engineers, we have a very public interface, very big public interface. And so we have to learn to be messengers. If we are not good communicators as transportation engineers, we will fail. It's just, I've seen it happen personally. You've got to be very cognizant of becoming good communicators. I would even go so far as to say this, that one of your crafts or your habits should be learning how to become a better communicator. I'm convinced of that more than ever. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention the intersection control evaluation process. In the ICE study here in Minnesota, that basically is it's a process where we can form existing conditions, formally consider a range of options for strategies, and then have an objective process to make a decision on a recommendation for a final alternative. It's basically the way you can condense that. In Minnesota, based on this tech memo from MnDOT, all intersections on the highway system, if you're doing a geometric change, they do require an ICE study. So be aware of that. But even at the county level for St. Louis County, we've been doing ICE studies on our big projects like this since 2010, 11-ish. So even if it's not required, I highly recommend this process. It's a great process to go through. It does a couple things, a couple benefits. Number one is it provides legacy information for your agency, so you, the future engineer will be able to figure out why did he make that decision? So it's documented that way. But also from a political perspective, I can then demonstrate to the public that, look, I went through 5 minutes. Oh, my. I can demonstrate from a political perspective that I thought about this stuff. All right, I just got the word that I got 5 minutes left and about 10 slides. So we're going to go through this pretty fast.
Go over them a little bit.
Okay. How about if I have 5 extra minutes? Is that okay with you? Perfect. And for those of you out in the webinar land, if you have to leave, that's okay because I won't be able to see you anyway. All right, here's a list of innovative intersections. It's not all inclusive, but the first three are the ones I have personal experience with here in St. Louis County. I'm not going to talk about the Virgin Diamonds or Doug Handles. But here's some examples of innovative intersections that exist. I'm not going to go into details on the different aspects. I will say one thing about the design of these intersections. Remember I mentioned about becoming good communicators as transportation engineers? We need to make sure we're saying consistent things to the public. Like if I were to define what a roundabout is, that'll be the same way that a transportation engineer in Mankato or Tampa, Florida defines a roundabout. Because it's very important that people can get confused if they hear one engineer saying something, another engineer saying something different. Unique about roundabouts, I mean, the title of the presentation is Leveraging Low-Cost Solutions. Roundabouts are one of those objects. It's generally a more expensive solution than a traditional approach. I'm sorry, it's just the way it is. And so then it really makes us think about what kind of benefits are we achieving with this roundabout design? And one of the benefits I think that roundabouts really fit a good niche for the second bullet point underneath typical installations is on the suburban areas of urbanized areas, you'll typically have these intersections that have concentrated peak hours for 20-30 minutes in the morning, 20-30 minutes in the afternoon, maybe up to 45 minutes to an hour of each. But for 22 hours out of the day, it's basically dead. When you put in a traffic signal, I call that a penalty device at that intersection because now you're penalizing all these people. They're actually incurring a lot more delay than they would have had if you just kept it as an always stop or a side street stop control. So roundabouts, in my opinion, are a great tool for those suburban intersections that have high concentrations of peak hour traffic, but very little traffic throughout the day. Because they are very efficient at moving traffic in low volume conditions, whereas traffic volumes are very inefficient at moving traffic during low volume conditions. Many roundabouts, I'm going to say that Federal Highway Administration is really making a push for this recently. Talked to Will Stein here in our Minnesota Federal Highway Administration office. He'll talk about many roundabouts. Basically, it's the same concept except it has traversable islands and traversable center islands and traversable splitter islands for trucks. But they're smaller in footprint. You can fit them in city streets. One thing I'll say about roundabouts in the public messaging is be aware of the truck conversation. I think that in the as the conversation of roundabouts has evolved through time, I think we're beyond the point of the public sentiment of do they work. The question now, the big debate of today, is trucks. So be very, very careful when you're designing a roundabout, you're part of a roundabout project, that you can demonstrate that trucks can actually pass through it. Specifically, give consideration to those oversized loads, especially those contractors that are moving such as maybe an asphalt batch plant, maybe a crusher that have low clearance underneath the trailers. Just be aware of that on the roundabouts. Reduce conflict intersections. Now here's one that is significantly less in cost compared to its counterpart, the interchange, about a tenth of the cost. It's an indirect turn movement. Reduces the conflict, eliminates the right angle of conflict points. In Minnesota, the experience, this is one of, I think, the greatest success stories of Minnesota. If you go to the Office of Traffic Safety, you'll find a report that was published a couple years ago. They looked at 7 years of after period of data of RCIs, complete elimination of fatal and serious crash intersections. Everywhere, at the time of the report was written, all the intersections that they considered reviewed, complete elimination of fatal and serious intersection crashes, 100% reduction. In my tool bag of intersection safety strategies, I don't really have any number of tools to begin with, but almost no tools that are 100% effective. Public messaging, the two biggest concerns you're gonna hear here at the RCI discussion, business access and emergency response. I was involved in the process here to build a J-turn this summer, but the public messaging part of it, it was those two areas that I had to debate the public at publicly in the public input meeting, and afterwards was, how do I get my people to my gas station so it doesn't shut down? Because they think of it as splitting the highway, and how do I maintain emergency response? One thing about a J-turn that I would think, that I found two things that were very beneficial, is creating a traffic volume map like this. It demonstrates that when you install a J-turn, you only impact about 5 to 10% of all vehicles going through the intersection. So for impacting direct on a direct case, 5 to 10% of vehicles, I can achieve 100% reduction in fatal and serious crashes. This is a great illustration because it shows you that on the side street, the direct lefts and the direct throughs, the size of those arrows represent the proportion of traffic. Look at how small those arrows are on the side street left and throughs. This really puts it in a good perspective. That's something we came up in St. Louis County in that public meeting process. The second thing was, well, the RCI, the J-turn, is going to really increase my crossing time, and it's going to be really bad for emergency vehicles. Well, I actually did this personally. I found that a J-turn, in this case specifically, the U-turn is 1,300 feet from the main intersection. I found that a J-turn underneath low volume conditions increases your crossing movement time by 30 seconds, which is less than a traffic signal. Because here's the thing, the public will say, just put in a traffic signal at that J-turn intersection, it'd be pretty much better. And what I can say to them is, hey, you just told me you don't like the increase in delay, but actually, I want to talk about apples to apples. Your signal is going to be more delay in the side street than my J-turn. Messaging point. Here's a map of J-turns. Continuous green T intersections. This is basically a capacity of driving or traffic operation strategy. We did do one in St. Louis County. It's just north here by the airport. From our perspective, it's been very, very successful. Great public response. How do I know that's been a good public response? Nobody's called me. So it's been fantastic response. And people who I've talked to, they really love it. So one last thing I'll throw out there is I'll close by this. In the lower right-hand corner is a picture of a submarine. The reason I threw that in there is because when we as engineers are leading these projects, in every single project, there is somebody or some people that are submarines looking to torpedo your project. They will. Guaranteed, there, every single project, well, maybe not every, 99% of the projects you're going to find a submarine. I'll just put it that way. And one of the very first things you need to do in that first bullet point is you get your destroyers out there and start looking for the submarines. How do you do that? You meet early and often with the elected officials. Early and often with the elected officials. You will find who the submarines are. And once you find who they are, then you can tailor your message so you can prevent that. So basically, you're putting up a big net around your ship, you know, so you can't get that torpedo under there. Third point down, this is really key as part of the public messaging. Never, ever, 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 ever show up at a public meeting for the first time with a CAD drawing of an intersection. Because in the public's eye, that means you've already had a foregone conclusion. This is what they're doing. In fact, they got it designed. In fact, they're probably, just based on the design on the window on the screen up there, they must be bidding this thing next week. Yeah, they have a process. It'll be available. I'm not going to mention anything about safety plans. Third bullet point down, do your homework. Don't rely on canned statements. This is part of the messaging part. As with any extra bullet, that's why we don't have computers doing our job. That's why we have engineering judgment. And at the end, I'll have here's some resources for you. And I know we probably have very little time for questions, but thank you very much. I apologize that I had to rush to the end of the presentation, but I do appreciate your the opportunity to give a speech to you guys. Back to first.
The safety benefits of J-turn or run others are clearly fantastic, but I rarely hear much about the lack of need for ongoing maintenance and operations with a roundabout, for example. You might have some street lighting, but you don't have to have signal, and you know, so with bad weather, you don't have signals going out, going to the flash mode, all that stuff, and you don't have a traffic engineer call the car in the morning because they have to go turn it on. So is that a non-significant point?
All right, so for those in the webinar line, if you can't hear, the question was, do the maintenance considerations of a roundabout versus a traffic signal, are those significant enough aspect to justify a roundabout versus a traffic signal? I think it's kind of what you're thinking here. So, I have found that because of the magnitude of scale and cost difference, you're looking at about 50 to 100% more for a roundabout than a signalized intersection. It would take the whole life of the traffic signal to pay for that difference or probably less. I've used that argument before. I think it's a valid argument to a certain extent. But the math, in my opinion, usually doesn't work out that it would say that I can achieve that benefit of eliminating those maintenance concerns. So I do still believe it's a valid point that roundabouts don't result in these issues, and I think it's key. I mean, take, for example, the snowstorm is coming tomorrow. We're going to have signals. Indications are going to be caked with snow because it's going to be a heavy wet snow. Signal will still be operating, but you won't be able to see what the signal is. That won't be the case at our roundabouts. So, you had a question here.
Yeah. As far as like detailed safety, have you found a way to kind of merge in your one slide? You had traffic volumes and conflict points, or what kind of impacts safety. Have you found a way to like kind of combine those two at intersections where you can do more of an analysis for a site-specific type intersection?
What do you mean by combining the conflict points and traffic volumes?
Just looking at, you know, if you have two two-way stop signals in different locations, can you say that one is worse than the other somehow by combining both, like, your conflict diagram and volumes? Have you looked into that type of analysis
before? I don't think I have. The best thing I think I can answer your question is at that level it becomes a site-specific analysis to say what percentage of my crashes are angle crashes at this intersection.
I found like there's a lot of traffic operations analysis that you can do at site-specific, but not a lot of safety analysis.
Sure. Yeah. Good question. I don't know if I really have an answer for you at the top of my head right now. So.
Yeah.
Any questions in webinar land?
Check with Jordan here.
Any questions?
I think we're all right on this end.
Okay, we're back live. And there's one question. No, I got it right here. Can you speak to how modes, vehicles, walking, biking play into these strategies for innovative intersections?
Okay, good question. When it comes to signalized intersections or at-grade intersections like this, well, specifically think about signalized intersections. If you look at the pedestrian crash data in any metropolitan area, this speaks well towards innovative intersections where I'm going with this. If you ask the question, where do most of our serious bike crashes occur? Number one, they're within urbanized areas. Number two, they're at signalized intersections that have speeds of 30 miles per hour. So the number one location that pedestrians and bicyclists are being killed in the state of Minnesota, signalized intersections, low speed. I couldn't find a better answer to say a roundabout removes all those conflict points, and it actually, we found, you know, the experience wide is that roundabouts are much better for pedestrians and bicyclists because, number one, you're removing those conflict points and changing them in sequence. So you're addressing a conflict with a pedestrian before you get to the intersection, and then you have to navigate or merge in with the vehicles in the roundabout. So when it comes to J-turns or RCIs, traditionally, or typically, I should say, you're dealing with an intersection that's more rural environment, so you're probably not going to be dealing with bicycle ped issues as much. But I do know the Minnesota DOT geometric office is very, they do prompt you and encourage you to think about accommodating bikes and peds at J-turn intersections like the one we're going this summer north of Duluth. We're including ped crossings, primarily because there's a community center on one side, there's a gas station on the other side. If it weren't for those two things, I probably would have put my foot down a little harder and said, I don't want to provide accommodation for pet bike at a rural intersection treatment like that. All right, thank you very much.
So we have a presentation for you, it's an NCITE pet folio.
Oh my.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have anything else? Thanks, Jonah. Yeah, you know, just one last item. Just want to thank everybody. Thank the Duluth Transportation Student Organization. Thank UMD. Thank all our guests up here. Thanks to everybody that was down in Minneapolis. I appreciate everybody showing up and listening. So that's it. Have a great day. Thank you very much.
Awesome. Well, thank you again for coming.